Hello. In the previous lecture, we discussed how to deal with laminar flows and did a simple example. Today, we are going to take a look at more cases, and we will see how to deal with pressure differences and with gravity. We have seen that we could set up a momentum balance that we could turn into a force balance. The only forces acting in the case we discussed were two shear stresses. The shear stress is an example of a surface force. It acts on the surface of our control volume. So does the pressure, as we will see in a minute. Gravity is different. It's a body force. That is, it works on the entire control volume. A quick recap of what Newtonian fluence is shown on the slide. The bottom line is that the shear stress, that is the friction per unit area, is proportional to the velocity gradient. The proportionality constant is the viscosity mu. There's a property of the fluid, like the density. Our second case is a thin film of Newtonian fluid between two very large vertical walls. Now gravity cannot be neglected. There is no pressure difference in the fluid. As always, we start our analysis with a sketch. We define our coordinate system and take x equals 0 in the middle of the fluid layer. The distance between the two plates is thus 2d. There's no need to do so. It will turn out to be handy, that's all. Again, we would like to compute the velocity field in the liquid, given that the flow is laminar and steady. All right, why will the fluid be flowing anyhow? In this case, gravity will pull the fluid down, and we can expect that the two plates will try to slow the resulting motion down. As we deal with velocity, we are going to set up a momentum balance for a small control volume somewhere in the fluid. It has size dx dy and a width w perpendicular to the sheet. Next question. Which momentum? Answer: momentum in the y direction, as gravity will pull liquid down. From symmetry we see that as much y momentum is convectively flowing in at the top as is leaving through the bottom of the control volume. Moreover, the flow is in steady state. Thus, like in the previous lecture, we can cast the momentum equation into a force balance. Sum of y components of the forces is zero. Let's draw the forces. First, gravity pointing downwards. Note that we write down minus rho g. The minus sign is because gravity works in the negative y direction, and g is a positive constant. Secondly, we don't write m times g, but rho times g. That is because we want to have the volume of our control volume explicitly in the equation. Next, we draw the shear stresses that work on the sides of the control volume. One on the left side at position x, and the other on the right side at x plus dx. By convention, the one of the left side points upwards, and this is from a layer with a smaller coordinate on a layer with a bigger coordinate. Hence, on the right side, we need to take a minus sign into account, stemming from action is minus reaction. As you can see in the drawing, both shear stresses point upwards. A little strange, isn't it? Well, actually, it's not strange. At this stage, we don't know what the direction of the friction forces are. We will find out what the sign is when we do the analysis. Time to set up the force balance. Tau xy at x times w dy plus minus tau xy at x plus dx times w dy minus rho g w dx dy is zero. Divide by w dx dy, and this can be turned into a differential equation for tau. D dx of tau sub xy is minus rho g. We can solve this equation easily and find that the shear stress decreases linear with x. In this case, the integration constant C1 can be found without having to solve the velocity profile. The argument is as follows. We have a symmetrical case. The left and the right side from the central dashed line are each other's mirror. That means that no momentum flow can flow from left to right or right to left, as that will break the symmetry. In formula, phi sub px at x equals 0 must be 0. But remember, phi sub px represents the same as tau xy. The one sees the action of viscosity as molecular momentum diffusion, the other as a friction force. Thus, we see that the integration constant is 0. And we find for the shear stress, tau sub xy equals minus rho gx. Note that the mass shows that the shear stress on the left part is positive and on the right part negative. Try to figure out for yourself why this is true. Further note that we haven't used at all what kind of fluid we have. It could be air, it could be water, but equally well something like toothpaste or any other kind of strange liquid. In other words, the shear stress profile does not depend on the kind of fluid. Now that we have the shear stress profile, we can compute the velocity profile. Here we use that we are working with a Newtonian fluid. So, we have the relation between the shear stress and the velocity gradient. From that, we solve the velocity profile. We have to integrate once, and thus have one integration constant. This can be found via a boundary condition. We have two of them. Vy is 0 at x is d, and at x is minus d. But these are actually the same due to the symmetry in the problem. Finally, we get the solution. Vy is a parabola, and the fluid is flowing downwards as we expected. Note that the shear stress profile is in line with the velocity. At the left side, the fluid layer with the smaller coordinate is as more negative, moves slow, and exerts thus an upward friction force on the adjacent layer with a larger coordinate. At the right-hand side, it's just the other way around. Our next example will deal with flow through a straight tube. Again, the fluid will be Newtonian. It is known as Hagen-Poiseuille flow after the French researcher Poiseuille and the German Hagen, who independently derived the equation for this flow around 1840. It will also bring the pressure into the equation. The geometry is a straight cylindrical pipe. It has a radius r and a length l. Over this length, a pressure drop delta p forces the fluid to flow from left to right. The fluid flows laminar and in steady state. Question: what is the shear stress profile in the fluid? And what is the velocity profile? Finally, we're going to see that the Fanning friction factor for Poiseuille flow is indeed exactly 64 over Reynolds. We first set up a force balance. A good choice of the control volume is a ring out of the fluid domain with length dx and an inner and outer radius r and r plus dr. This is shown in the figure. If we zoom in, we can see better. The fluid is flowing into the ring through the gray area on the left and out through the gray area on the right. The momentum balance also in this case reduces to a force balance, balancing all forces in the x direction. As gravity is vertically oriented, we can leave this out of the discussion. Two types of forces are acting: shear stress on the inner and outer surface of the cylindrical ring, and pressure forces on the gray parts. First, we draw in the two shear stresses. Note again the sign convention. Next, the pressure force. P at position x is pushing from the outside on the gray area, and P at x plus dx is pushing at the other side in the opposite direction. These four forces must balance. Of course, both pressure and shear stress need to be multiplied by the area on which they act to get the forces. Since this is a cylindrical geometry, the areas need some attention. The pressure works on the gray rings. They have areas 2 pi r dr. For the shear stress, we need to make a distinction. At r, the area is 2 pi r dx, while at r plus dr, it is 2 pi r plus dr dx. Thus, we get as force balance, tau at r times 2 pi r dx plus minus tau at r plus dr times its corresponding area at r plus dr plus the two pressure forces is zero. We can take out the factor 2 pi and we can divide by dr dx. If we look at the resulting equation, we see that the pressure terms get grouped and can be written as r dp dx. The shear stresses are also grouped, but if you look careful, you will see that one stress is multiplied by r and the other by r plus dr. Hence, it doesn't reduce to r times the derivative of tau, but rather to the derivative of r times tau. If you find this difficult, look up the case of the heated cylinder. There you will see the same features, but now for temperature. So, we arrive at the differential equation for the shear stress. ddr of r tau equals minus r dp dx. The pressure gradient dp dx is a constant. It does not depend on x, as the tube is very long. Hence, there is an axial symmetry. It does not depend on r either, as we left out gravity. Thus, there are no vertical forces acting rather than the pressure. Consequently, as nothing is accelerating in the vertical direction, the pressure must be the same everywhere. We integrate this equation once and simplify to get tau equals minus dp dx times half r plus c1 over r. The integration constant is zero. As like the previous example, this case has symmetry around r is zero. Thus, no momentum can flow through the x-axis. Hence, the final solution is tau is minus dp dx times half r. The velocity profile is now found the standard way. Use that we deal with a Newtonian liquid. Put in the boundary conditions that at the wall of the tube, the velocity is zero, and solve the equation. We find that the velocity is a parabola of the radial position. This is Hagen-Poiseuille's solution of the linear flow of a Newtonian fluid in a straight cylindrical tube. It holds for cases with a Reynolds number of 2300 or less, with Reynolds based on the average liquid velocity. In this sheet, we have summarized our finding. A straight shear stress profile and a parabolic velocity profile. A few characteristics. The mean velocity is half of the maximum velocity. The volume flow rate is related to the pressure drop as given on the sheet. Finally, now that we have the average velocity, we can write this as a relation between delta p and the half rho v squared. This is the form we found for the Fanning friction factor for flow in a straight pipe. Delta p is 4f L over d half rho v squared. Thus, we can conclude that indeed the Fanning friction factor for this case is exactly given by 4f is 64 over Reynolds. This concludes our lecture about laminar Newtonian flows. Check out the glass plate for more examples and practice yourself. As always, starting with a good drawing. Good luck and see you in the next lecture.